Have you wondered about how AI, artificial intelligence, affects ancestry and maybe the future of it, as well as some other questions that you might have about ancestry? I am so lucky I'm here at the National Genealogical Society's conference, and I'm here with Crista Cowan of Ancestry, and we're going to talk just about that. So, Crista, thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Tell me a little bit more, you know, AI is the hot topic right now, right? Mm-hmm. We're talking all about it with Chat GPT, everybody's on fire, and it's such a great topic. But Ancestry's been using AI for a while, and I'd love to hear more about how Ancestry uses AI and what you anticipate in the future.
Yeah, it is a hot new topic, and everybody kind of thinks, oh, it's this new thing on the scene, but we've been using it for over a decade. Ways that people might not realize AI is used. The little leaf hints you get on Ancestry, that's all run by artificial intelligence. Whenever you get a new DNA match, that's run by artificial intelligence. Of course, the big news last year was the 1950 US Census. Handwriting recognition was used to index that in 9 days, as opposed to the 9 months it took to index the 1940 census.
I know.
That's artificial intelligence. So all of this has been used in the genealogy industry, and particularly at Ancestry, for over a decade now. So it's just a matter of the next evolution of AI in this space.
Well, so tell everybody, what are some of the next evolutions? Because you and I were talking and you told me about a census record.
Yeah.
Can you share that with everybody?
I can, yeah. So the 1931 Canada Census just came out on June 1st, so just a couple of days ago as of the recording here. And Ancestry had all those digital images downloaded and then published on Ancestry in less than 24 hours. As soon as we started downloading those images from the Library Archives Canada, we put that handwriting recognition technology to work, and we had the entire thing indexed in about 2 days. That's crazy when you think about it.
2 days!
Right? Now, of course, it's not published yet. We have to still put it through QA. We want to make sure that the handwriting tool did its job correctly, so it still requires some human intervention. And it's just kind of ironic to me now, though, that that human intervention is going to take longer than the process it took to actually get it indexed. We used to be able to kind of keep pace with the QA and the indexing, but now that AI has allowed us to speed up that process so much.
So when do you anticipate that census being available to everybody?
Fully searchable, probably within the next week or so.
That is so exciting.
Right?
and it's just getting better, right?
Yeah.
So like the next thing that comes along, and I love the handwriting recognition too, because that's transferring over into so many other places where wills and deeds and all of these beautiful records that some of them aren't even indexed that we have now that are just... so exciting. Where do you see that going? Yeah.
You know, it's interesting. If you kind of look at the history of Ancestry, so Ancestry went online in 1997. From 1997 to 2022, we put about 40 billion records online. In 2022, we put 5 billion records online
in just one year
because of this technology. Yeah. And now in 2023, we're pacing to have 15 billion records put online this year. And it's a lot of it's due to the handwriting recognition technology.
Yeah.
Some of it's due to some of the new OCR technologies for reading things like newspapers and city directories and yearbooks. Anytime a record is typed, we can apply even more technology to that.
That's so amazing. I just love it because I think back, I've been doing genealogy for about 40 years now. And when I started, you know, you're in the microfilm reader, reading the microfilm, and I bet a lot of you out there can understand what I'm talking about. But then, all of a sudden, you know, Ancestry came online, Family Search went into their programs, things, you could start attaching records to your tree, then the leafs and the hints and all of these different, and every platform has their different version of the leaf, right? But, and that just accelerated things, the indexing of things. I mean, in the last 10 years, things have changed so much. And with artificial intelligence and like the Chat GPT and being able to textualize things, you know, like put them in, what's the word for that, verbiage or whatever, being able to do that, I just anticipate another explosion in genealogy. And I just can't wait.
I know, it's really exciting. Yeah, ChatGPT is kind of an interesting space. Of course, at Ancestry, we're always looking to the new technology to see what can be done and what can't be done. But even just personally as a genealogist, I've taken some transcriptions I made sometimes years ago of deeds or wills, run them through ChatGPT and asked it to extract information from that or to, we use the word translate, but but what we really mean is put this in layman's terms, right?
Oh,
it's already in English.
I've never done that.
Yeah. So you take the transcript of a deed or a will, you dump it in there, you say, summarize this for me, and it will take that information and put it into layman's terms so that you understand exactly what's happening. And that's a super fun application of AI as well.
I haven't done that. Okay. Anybody that does that, put that into the comments and let me know how it is for you. That's the thing I'm going to try when I get home. So what are some of the other things that are happening at Ancestry that really have you on fire? Anything else that you can share?
Yeah, so right now what we're working on is a lot of, we use the word community, but collaboration tools really. One of the things we're hearing from a lot of our customers is that people want to work together, but they're not always sure how, or they're not always comfortable with sharing stuff. And so one of the new features is that you can see exactly what changes have been made in your tree by yourself or any editors. So I own my tree. My dad and my mom are both editors. I was a little nervous about that because that's my work. That's the time and money that I have poured into this tree to make it as good as possible, and just opening it up to other people, even my parents, made me super nervous. But now I can go in every day and see exactly what changes my dad's made, and if he does anything I don't like, I can undo it. Sorry, Dad. And so that's, like, I like that. We also have a new feature that's group circles, like family circles, so you can put all of your family members in a group, and you can create several of them, and then you can message them all at once. It's kind of like a group chat.
So that
we can have conversations about the discoveries we're making. We can ask questions. We can start conversations. I love throwing out a family memory and seeing how, all the different ways people remember things come back. So lots of different things like that we're kind of leaning into this collaboration space, because we really want... Family history has for so long been such an isolated experience. Yeah. In our pajamas at 2 o'clock in the morning doing family history. But it's family history, right? Yeah. And so it's really about how we involve people at the level that they're comfortable being involved with, and how we can facilitate that with technology.
I love that. And as a matter of fact, I just watched it this morning because it just came out yesterday as of this recording. You did a great video with Connie Knox where you actually showed those things.
Yeah.
So if you haven't seen it, because we can't do this here, watch Connie Knox's video on Genealogy TV about this. And Crista actually goes through and shows you how she's utilized those tools. And it's really pretty cool. So check that out. I wanted to kind of turn a little bit to DNA, because everybody loves DNA and it brings so many people into the industry. And I have to tell you, I was at this conference, I was at a AI conversation with a bunch of people that are here at the conference that are interested in it. And we had some great people there that were from different industries, and then just users like me who are interested in that. And one of the things that was said by Blaine Bettinger that I think maybe I hadn't really thought of, he talked about the side view.
Mm-hmm.
And that you guys have an ancestry, and he said, I don't think people realize, and Blaine Bettinger, by the way, is like kind of the industry man when you think of DNA, and he said, I don't think people realize how amazing that is,
mm-hmm.
and how before it was so much to be able to do that with your DNA matches, and that Ancestry's ability to do that is really because of the size of their DNA database.
Right.
And so if you aren't familiar with side view, that is really something that you need to take a look at. What are some of the other things on the DNA front that you think are kind of newer that maybe people don't understand, or just maybe some tips on how to better use the features that you guys have on DNA?
Yeah, so Ancestry has 23 million people who've tested. So yes, the size of the network is what allows us to do some of this. It's the largest consumer DNA network, and we're able to take that amount of data and look for patterns and start to understand connections. We're able to start to see if we apply this tool, will it work this way? And so SideView was born out of that. One of my favorite things about the whole DNA product experience is the genetic communities. So we now have more than 2,000 of them. And just kind of a quick primer, your ethnicity estimate is anything where you have a percentage. And the percentages are derived from comparing your DNA to a reference population of people from around the globe and saying your DNA looks most like these people. And what that's really giving you an idea of is where your DNA was in the world 500 to 1,000 years ago. Now, most of our trees don't go back that far and never will, but the communities are looking at where you have family members who have lived within the last 200 years.
Yeah.
And we're able to start to identify these because of the way that the 23 million DNA testers are clustering into networks. And when we see a cluster or a network start to form in the data, we can say, what do these people have in common? And we're able now to get some genetic communities down to like a 10-mile square radius of land. We can say, you're from this spot of this county in Ireland, or you are from an African-American community in this county in Mississippi. Like, we can get that specific.
That's so amazing.
So if you know nothing about your family history, that's going to be your first discovery.
Yeah.
And even if you do know something about your family history, if you've got a brick wall, if you don't understand exactly where in the place your family came from, we can give you a target to hit.
That is so awesome.
Yeah.
Love that. That I really am. I'm so excited about this industry and where it's going, because it's just exploding so quickly. Well, that's one of the reasons that I actually really love Roots Tech, because if you go to Roots Tech, I'm plugging Roots Tech for next year.
Always.
Everybody is there. So if you want to know about what is happening with the different businesses in the industry, they will be there and you will be seeing some of the latest and greatest. To me, that's just kind of an exciting part about the industry. Any other thoughts on like what's happening and what you anticipate and what you are looking forward to?
Yeah, you know, Ancestry has committed to invest tens of millions of dollars into additional content over the next few years. And that's exciting to me because as a genealogist, I always want more records. Currently, there's records from 80 countries around the world, but we see new things like the 1931 census was just released by the government. There's constantly laws kind of shifting around access to birth, marriage, and death records.
Yeah.
One of my favorite things is the amount of newspapers that are coming online. The newspapers.com has billions of pages of newspapers, and Ancestry has been able to go through again with AI technology and identify boundaries of articles, identify content of articles, tag them as a certain type of article, and then index them and make those indexes searchable on Ancestry. So a few years ago, we released the marriages index for newspapers, then we released the obituaries index for newspapers.
Yeah.
We're currently in the process of releasing state by state what we're calling the stories and events index. So if your dad got a merit badge in his Boy Scout troop and put in the newspaper, or if your grandmother sued your grandfather for bigamy, it's in the newspaper, or if, you know, somebody took a trip to visit their daughter who had a new baby, like all those little, you know, Facebook-like snippets of social news that were in newspapers for decades,
yeah.
We're indexing those right now and making that searchable. So super exciting.
That's
because
awesome.
You may discover things you didn't know and
yeah.
See little insights into their daily lives.
Which is, but that to me, the icing of genealogy, right? Finding the names and finding out who the people were are one thing, but being able to get the details, that's really the icing.
Mm-hmm.
And so often that comes out of newspapers.
Absolutely.
So, as a matter of fact, one of the things that came up in this AI meeting that I went to yesterday was the anticipation of somebody sometime being able to take the optical character recognition that we use in newspapers, which because of the print is not all that great, and maybe then putting it into the conversational chat GPT, and that might open up doors. So that's my hope someday with Ancestry. I would love to see that.
So would I.
So anyway, maybe that's something that we could see someday. Well, I am so excited about all of this. Thank you so much for sitting down and talking to me a little bit about all of the great things that you're doing at Ancestry with AI. Krista's amazing. If you don't catch her on Ancestry in the different Barefoot Genealogist posts and YouTube videos and things like that she does, check them out because they're great. Thank you so much for doing this with me. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Like the video if this has been of help to you, and check out some of these other videos. Have a great day.